God is my source, God is my power, God is my everything. So I give thanks for all my blessings, God is my everything I need. Yeah, yeah, yeah. God is my source, God is my power, God gives my everything I need. So I give thanks for all my blessings, God gives my everything I need. God gives my everything I need. God gives my
If you're here for the first time today, I'm not Reverend Mike. I just want you to know that. Reverend Mike is off on a minister's conference in Dallas this week, and so he will not be in the office, but Aaron will be here Monday through Thursday from 9 to 1, or whatever time she's here. So at the center, we do hugs and handshakes. Turn and greet someone with a hug or handshake and make a new friend. That I'm making a declaration, but when there's this few people here, everybody gets to get hugged and handshaked. That's the best part of it, right? Yes. Good morning again, everybody, if you've just come in. Our call to service at the center is called Lighting the Flames of Faith. We perform this ceremony to promote the universal consciousness of life, which acknowledges that all faiths, all beings, all sentient beings come from that one great universal presence, which we call spirit. Fundamental to this truth is the unifying nature of all religious thought and experience, which we honor here today. Reverend Elizabeth Schneider is our practitioner and presider for this service this morning. As she lights the first candle, it is for the Tao, honoring the path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way. The second candle we light for the shamanic traditions, honoring the beliefs and practices of all indigenous peoples, the way of primal spirituality. The third candle we light for Hinduism, honoring the path of knowledge, action, and devotion. The fourth candle we light for all forms of, or for Judaism, rather, honoring the ethical path of living by sacred law. Oh, I have my glasses here. That would be helpful. The fifth candle we light for all forms of Buddhism, honoring the Four Noble Truths in the path of compassion. The sixth candle we light for all forms of Christianity, honoring the Christ consciousness as the path of love. The seventh candle we light for all forms of Islam, honoring the path of submission to the will of God as the highest calling. The eighth candle we light for the universalistic religion of Baha'i, honoring the path of unity and peace. We light the ninth candle for all forms of new thought, honoring the metaphysical path of mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. We light the 10th candle for all those who are yet unaware of the power and presence of spirit in their lives and for the space that we are holding for them at this center. And as Reverend Elizabeth lights the healing candle, please put silently into the light the names of anyone you wish to experience the healing flame of God's eternal love.
In this moment, in this place, I remember who I am, letting fear and worry fall away from me. I open my eyes and I see there is only love. There is only love. Love that heals, love that sets us free. There is only love.
So please join me this morning. Join me in consciousness as I speak my word for each and every person here. So I declare right here and right now, God is. I am one with life. As I speak my word, I know the law responds with demonstrations, and I expect the best. So the best becomes part of my experience. I am open and receptive to divine mind to work through me, for me, and as me. And I declare it done unto me as I believe, and every day I deepen my belief, my faith, and my knowing in divine guidance. And every day my thought moves toward more harmony, peace, love, health, joy, and more. And I speak with confidence to create my best life, knowing the power of the universe is surging to express itself through me. And I'm filled with faith, love, and expectancy of good, blotting out all beliefs of limitation, lack, unhappiness. So I attract the good into my life. Plenty, peace, power, life, truth. I'm confident, strong, powerful, happy, and loving, and I am in sync with divine mind. And I stride, and I abide, and I live in eternal harmony. As the power of the universe is with me, I feel it, I know it, I act as if it's true, and I gratefully receive and give thanks for divine guidance and more, and I release my word to the law, knowing it returns to be multiplied abundantly. And together we say, so it is. So good morning. So recently I was exercising on the elliptical at my gym. And as is my practice, I had a paperback book with me from the library. And because I like to read while I'm exercising. So upon leaving, though, I realized I had forgotten my book. So I checked the restroom. I went back to the machines. Wasn't there. And I told the girl at the desk I gave her my phone number and my name as the book turned up to call me. And just let me know. So she took my information. And I did a spiritual mind treatment on the way to the car that the book would be recovered safely. And it was a library book, and it's expensive to replace it through the library, but if you can get it through Amazon cheaper, that's a better way to go. So after a few days, she didn't call, and I ordered the book from Amazon. So the next time I went to the gym, she smiled and she saw me, oh, I have your book. So I realized I had lost faith. I lost faith. Spiritual mind treatment was activated as soon as I went to the car, but I didn't have patience. I didn't trust the treatment would work. And so I ordered the book. So this is a small thing, right? Why bring it up? Because sometimes a demonstration takes time to, it's not immediate. Sometimes it's working and we don't know it. Sometimes it doesn't work because we actually don't believe our treatment. And in my case, it worked, but then my trust in the process eroded. It eroded, and it was a minor thing, but it caused me to really look at my relationship to affirmative prayer and to the principles of spiritual mind treatment, of science of mind. And I've been having a number of what I call phase of life issues and physical challenges this year. This is the year I turned 80, and what do you know? There was sleep apnea, I had urinary tract infections, I see some intestinal thing, cataracts, dental issues, regular heartbeat, leg injury from the gym, and to top it off, I broke a toe. Then I had anxiety about all this swirling around in my head, and then insomnia kicked in. Well, sometimes I feel like a basket case, but too much monkey mind, too much, you know, anxiety and fear roaming around. So I decided I better immerse myself back into the principles. So I'm taking Science of Mind 103 with Reverend Kathy and Jessica, and it's bringing me back to basics. And even though I've taken these classes before, and I'm actually an ordained minister, so I'm embarrassed to even be admitting all this, but I'm finding fresh inspiration by going back to these basics, to rereading Ernest Holmes, and then learning about the meditation and the benefits, because I've got to say I've never been a good meditator. So it's just not enough to declare our intention with our objective mind. And I have a really good objective mind. I'm very intellectual. But we must work at it until the unconscious or subconscious actually believes what we're saying. So I can declare there is one supreme intelligence which governs, guides, and guards and tells me what to do, when to act, and how to act. But it's not enough to just say it. I must know it, see it, feel it, be it. And if I do this every day, then I can rebuild and build my trust and my belief and my faith. And only then can I move toward actual, truly knowing the truth of the creative process and all that is. So I find meditation helps because this is where we can quiet the mind and relax the body and be open and receptive to spirit. And I like this little book, The Joy of Meditation, which is part of the class, and because it shows different ways to meditate. And I liked one that was called Letting Go with Balance. And so this fit me because first I can sit in the silence and then I can periodically let go of each and every one of these little aggravations and irritations and anxieties and things and fears that have been bothering me until I feel this emptiness and this sense of freedom. Then in the second part of the meditation, I interject the silence with these declarations. God is able. God is able to heal each and every one of these concerns. So with this meditation, then I can let go of all these monkey mind anxieties, accept my highest good. And as I practice this, my goal is a more balanced, healthy life and a deep knowing that, hey, yes, God is all there is. And this includes me, and so it is.
And so it is. Good morning, everyone. Really nice to see you. Please welcome David and Kent and the group. And we are really pleased to have our next guest here. It's the first time that she's been here to sing. Please give a warm welcome to Miss Cheryl Khalid. Positive. One, two, a one, two.
Got you accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative and don't mess with Mr. in between. Got down to a minimum and have faith, or pandemonium's liable to walk upon the scene. To illustrate my last remark, Jonah in the whale, Noah in the ark. What did they do just when everything looked so dark? Well, they said you gotta accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative and don't mess with Mr. In Between. You gotta spread joy to a maximum and bring gloom down to a minimum and have faith, or pandemonium's liable to walk upon the scene. Accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative and don't mess with Mr. In Between. Oh no, don't mess with Mr. In Between. Uh-uh, don't you mess with Mr. In Between.
Now, thanks to you. Now it's time for the announcements, and since I don't have a list of them, I'm relying on the PowerPoint of announcements. Otherwise, oh, okay. Science of my 103, that's the class I'm in. It's really great, by the way. We're having a discovery class orientation on October 7th, 12:30. The Sangha is going on from September 19th to the 24th, and that's in the morning with Reverend Jean Hoffman. We have visioning every second and fourth Wednesday, 6 p.m. with Reverend Mike. And is that it? We have one more thing. We have Nikki is going to come up and tell us about the special fundraising dinner and tennis event, right?
Hi everyone. This Saturday, after you go to the street fair, so please go to the Granada Hills Street Fair and support our booth, we are doing, Barbara Cherney and I are doing a fun tennis event. Some of you are like, oh, I don't play tennis. Come out and join us. Tennis is from 3 to 5, and we will have rackets to borrow. Sign up in Sparks Hall so we can get a head count. If you need a racket, just let me know on the sign-up sheet, and we'll have rackets for you. And it's just a fun, social, if you don't even want to play tennis, bring a lawn chair and sit out at the park. It's at El Carrizo Park. And the tennis portion is from 3 to 5, and then we have a delicious, yummy dinner, a little Mediterranean flair provided by Sherman Way Marketplace from 5 to 6. There'll be raffle prizes and lots of good stuff for you to participate. So I do hope you'll come and join us. The proceeds will go to our teen fund. And it's a lot of fun. We did it last year. So please sign up, and we'll see you next Saturday after the street fair. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikki. Sounds great. And looked like Judy had her hand up, so she's got something to announce. So 12:30 today, the lay pastoral care? Okay, great. All right, so now we have the Declaration of Principles, if you'll stand. And this should be up here also. We believe in one universal spirit manifesting through all, natural and incarnated in us. We believe that universal spirit is personal too, and reveals itself through everyone who recognizes his presence. And we believe our faith operates upon a law of mind, which automatically manifests in our experience according to that faith. And we believe in the unity of all life and the immortality of the individual soul forever expanding. We believe in the inward goodness, eternal loving kindness, and the givingness of life to all.
Reverend Elizabeth, very much, very much. I appreciate your message. Thank you. And Cheryl and the band, yay. Yay, oh yay. So welcome everybody who might be on the live stream this morning. If you just wave a bit at them so they can see that there's a few people here this morning. I want to thank Reverend Mike for asking me to fill in for him. For those of you who might be new to the center this morning, I am the former pastor of this center for 14 and a half years. I was here, and I get to come back every once in a while just to keep my fingers in the pie and enjoy it. I enjoy being here. I think it was February where I spoke somewhere three times in a month, and I thought, oh, that's too much like work. So I've decided once a month is good. Once a month is good. Keeps me in. So this morning, the talk title is not a misprint. It is Loose the Consciousness, not Lose the Consciousness. We don't ever want to lose the consciousness. And the monthly theme for the Centers for Spiritual Living is Good Vibrations Through Spiritual Mind Treatment. So Elizabeth happens to be my visual aid for the morning. It was so cute how Nikki, when she did the opening creative thought, fell right into what I wanted to say. Now it falls right into what I want to say again. I want everyone to understand the definition of loose. To loose means to free or release. To loose one's consciousness means to free or release one's consciousness. If you don't know what spiritual mind treatment is and you're new to the center or fairly new to the center, spiritual mind treatment consists of five steps of treatment. It's formulaic in nature as opposed to the kind of supplicating prayer that you might have learned in more traditional religion. But it is affirmative prayer. It's affirmative prayer because we are not asking for anything. Basically, what we are declaring is the truth about what it is that we desire to experience in life. In the traditional sense, prayer is often perceived, as I said, as supplication or begging. And it is, you know, that white bearded guy in the sky who is capricious at best and judgmental at worst, may need a few anger management classes. And this male god would mete out punishment or reward, as you know, if Marcy had been good this week, then she gets whatever it is she wants and prays for. And Nancy Shriver, who has not been quite so good this week, Shriver Dyer, would not. So in religious science, we have a different perception of God. We have a God that is good, a God that is generous, a God that is kind, is loving, and a God that who? God, that has to be that. Because Duke Ellington said one time, pretty soon there won't be a pronoun good enough for God. Do you hear that? Duke Ellington, great metaphysician, right? So God is God. God is God, period, the end. And so the God of our understanding always says yes. And as some of you know, well, wait one second here. Let me just move on here. We have this issue with consciousness, right? That Dr. Dennis Merritt Jones, who was my teacher, said that consciousness is the sum total of everything we've ever believed to be the truth about ourselves up to this point in time. So that means everything. It doesn't say one or two things. It doesn't say this thing or that thing. It says that everything that I've ever thought, said, or done got me where I am today. So it's all good. There's an Aramaic word loosely translated. Its Aramaic word is gomzo, G-O-M-Z-O, which means everything happens for good. So every single solitary thing, we only know it in retrospect, though. That's the thing. We have to, we may not be able to look at it closely when something first happens, but everything happens for good. We had to go through what we went through. We had to go through everything we went through to get to where we are today. Simple as that. So some of you know, I was raised by an unskilled mother. I have to say it that way, because otherwise I might reveal more about myself than I need to reveal this morning. But for so many years before coming to the Science of Mind, I held her personally responsible for everything that went wrong in my life. I mean, I did. I was very happy to tell anyone who would listen about my story. I mean, seriously. When Carolyn Mace said that we can be in a room of 100 people and if we've had, say, for instance, molestation issues, we will find the one person in that room that had molestation issues so we can talk about what happened from our woundology, right? Well, I told the story about my ineffective mother over and over and over again ad nauseum until someone gratefully told me, you know what, I've heard that story before. You know, maybe you might want to take a different tack on this. So as I evolved, I came to realize that my mom and I created a sacred contract. It was absolutely a sacred contract. And when Louise Hay said in her book, You Can Heal Your Life, You Choose Your Parents, I was just so angry at that. I threw the book across the room. But the reality is I did choose my mom, because if I had a different mother, I might not be standing before you today. My mother provoked self-realization in me, whether she knew it or not. She did. She was literally the catalyst that pushed me into finding the meaning of life, or trying to find the meaning of life. Taking it a step further, every person I've ever met in my life, whether for a reason or a season or a lifetime, as Michael Beckwith says, is also part of my sacred contract. That's true for everyone here, whether you believe it or not. And it's all good, because it's all God. as I evolved, I was able to free my consciousness of preconceived ideas that no longer served me and replace those old, outdated ideas with more progressive and forward-thinking ideas. It's not always easy to do that. Do we understand that? You know, we want to hold fast to what we think we believe the truth is. But sometimes it's in our best interest to have someone in this teaching who says to me, you know, could you entertain the possibility of looking at this differently? The people who are in my class with me this summer, you might hear me coming and going again. But I mean, I needed to hear this morning. That's why I'm talking about this. I really needed to hear this. None of us here today is the same person we were 5 years ago. Would you all agree?
Yes?
Yes? Well, we're not the same person we're going to be 5 years from now either. So we have to be totally immersed in the present moment to be spiritually enlightened. Here's the good news. As we release ourselves from a structure of knowing that no longer serves us, we are free to begin a new experience of life. So starting right today, you know, if you blame anybody for anything that happened in your life, starting today, you can't do that anymore. Because now you have a heightened awareness about who you are in relationship to that person. Because we attract those people into our lives to coach us at some level. And you know, if we've been coached really, really well, that person gets to be blessed. I mean, that may be hard in some circumstances. I totally understand that. But until I realized my relationship with God is my relationship with every other person I meet, my consciousness was stilted in a way. Until I had that awareness that when I look at Cheryl, I see God. When I look at Betsy, I see God. When I look at Jose, I see God. That it's not the person, it is the God essence of that person that I see. And you know, the longer I do that and the more often I do that, the easier it gets. It's just practice, 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 as we're told in this teaching. Ernest Holmes tells us to separate the act from the actor. Separate the act with... So this works with children. It works with other adults. It works with teenagers. It works with relatives, with parents, with employers, with employees. Anyone we might have invited into our lives. Separate the act from the actor. My son, I told this story earlier. My son, my daughter is 5 years older than my son. Piece of cake. We took her everywhere. She was the most well-behaved child you have ever seen in your life. She is acting out in her behavior in later life, however, but when she was younger, she was an incredible child. We would take her to the Tail of the Cock for dinner, and people would want to have their tables moved because they thought she was going to be an annoyance, but she was amazing, and Toddie can attest to that. I used to bring her over when she was 3 and 4 years old. Anyway, my son was the polar opposite. He was into so much mischief, you have no idea. You really have no idea. He was in an emergency room more times before he was 4 than Heather was in her whole life. Now, the last time we went to emergency was 4 and a half. He broke his arm. Excuse me. This time they called social services on me. I was humiliated. I was devastated because they separated me from him. They put him in a separate room, and they put me in this little room. Meantime, there's a fire in the air conditioning unit. The fire trucks came. His attention was diverted, and he didn't miss me quite so much, wasn't so anxious. And all of a sudden, I hear all this laughter out where he is getting his arm set. When they asked Nathan how he broke his arm, articulate 4 and a half year old said, I tripped over the hose my Uncle Michael had left in the garage and fell into the cat box. Damn good thing my sister just cleaned it. They're all hysterical, right? Now, my son's behavior was often unacceptable. Heather used to say, Mom, he's like Curious George. He just gets into mischief. He doesn't really mean any harm by it. He's just investigating things. He's interested in things, which was true. Didn't make it any easier, I got to tell you. I loved my son, but I didn't like his behavior sometimes. I didn't like his behavior. So I learned to free myself of thinking of him as a quote-unquote bad boy. You know, I grew up hearing, you're a bad girl. My brother grew up hearing, you're a bad boy. That's how people parented in those days. But he isn't a bad boy. He wasn't a bad boy. His behavior was often bad. But he is an inherently God-like child. And as a God-like child, was never bad. So I had to separate that. Now, I know this idea is much easier to utilize with children, little children especially. It's not so easy to use this with adults who are engaging in bad behavior. But it can work if we work it. It can work. You know, stop looking at the person as bad or dishonest or angry or whatever that person is acting out. Look at them as a God presence, you know? And you could say, even in your mind's eye, you could say, God, I know you're in there somewhere. It's a darn good disguise, but I know you're in there somewhere. So we have this crisis of confidence in our country right now, which translates, as Elizabeth talked about in her creative thought, as a crisis of faith for some of us. Even the most connected spiritual people I know right now are troubled about the ways of our current leadership. And don't worry, I'm not going to wax political here this morning. I'm just needing to use this as a bit of an example. I just want us to make the connection between separating the act and the actor in terms of what we see on the television. It can be done. We're religious scientists, for gosh sakes. We can do this. We have the power to see things differently than maybe other people might. So what I get from that, where there is incoherence, this incoherence is a separation from God. We are experiencing incoherence in our country right now. In order to loose our consciousness or free our consciousness or release our consciousness from judgments, we must heal the sense of separation that we're feeling. It doesn't mean we don't watch the news or listen to the news or read the papers. It means we do that to be informed. And every time we see something in the newspapers or on the news, it's a call to prayer, as Dr. Michael Beckwith has taught over the years. Maybe Michael Beckwith's thinking about me this morning, because I mentioned him twice. And I always think to myself, if he's talking about me as I'm talking about him, highly unlikely. So the admonition today is, do not stay in incoherence. You know, how long do you feel like you want to be miserable? How long do you feel you want to be angry? That's what incoherence is about. So put it like a set amount of time. Okay, I'm going to be angry for an hour. And then get over it. You know, Emma Curtis Hopkins says, we're spiritual beings. Now go out and act like it, for God's sake. That's what she says in one of her books. Go out and act like it, for God's sake. Do not perpetuate the frustration. Do not only see what's wrong, but see the things that are right for us. It's an opportunity for us to amp up our spiritual practice. Meditate more, pray more, read more inspirational books. See the possibility of change and move our feet in the direction of change. We cannot complain about our leadership because that keeps everyone stuck where they are. That goes for everybody. If I complain about my boss, I keep him stuck where he is. If I complain about my teenager, I keep her stuck where she is. If I complain about my husband, I keep him stuck where he is. Well, he's a different story, but, you know, You know how that is. Oh, my kids and my kid's dad are always the butt of a good Sunday talk, don't you know? So what we have to do is we have to do our prayer work around the eventuality that things are going to change, and they're going to change for the better. Thoughts become things. You'd never invite a thief into your home, so why would you allow thoughts that steal your joy to make themselves at home in your mind? Elizabeth said that in her creative thought. She figured it out. You know, how long do you want to perpetuate the thoughts of misery and pain and this hurts and that hurts? It's like, do something about it. Decide to be healthy, as Raymond Charles Barker says in his book. But deciding to be healthy and actually doing something about it are two different things. We can eat the kale, we can do the yoga, we can drink the alkaline water and take supplements. But if we don't deal with the unhealed stuff in our hearts and our minds, we are still unhealthy. Dr. Fletcher Harding used to say to me, he said, you know, I've seen people on their deathbed who are the healthiest people I know. And I said, well, how could that be? I said, they're getting ready to die. We had these long conversations at the end of his life, philosophical conversations. He never let me tape a single one. I said, why would that be? And he said, because they're spiritually healthy. That's all that matters. That's all that matters. So what do you do when there's a crisis of confidence resulting in a crisis of faith? What do we do? What does it take to free our consciousness from reacting to these things instead of being proactive and doing something to really affect change in some way? Someone asked the Dalai Lama one time what he should do when his mind was troubled. And the Dalai Lama asked him, do you meditate? And the man said, yes, I do. I meditate an hour a day. The Dalai Lama said, then meditate 2 hours a day. You know, if your mind is still troubled when you meditate, then you need to do a little bit more, make a little greater effort. Now, most of us who work, you know, outside the home or have jobs that require 8 hours of committed work time, 2 hours might be excessive, or it even might be a possibility if we have children and we have other things to take care of, run a household. But we do have 20 minutes. I happen to do transcendental meditation. And that 20 minutes sets the tone for the whole day. Now, I've had workers at my house for the last 4 weeks, and sometimes they interrupt my spiritual practice in the morning. They get there at the crack of dawn sometimes. But I still meditate at some point when they go to lunch or when they're not there, or when I just go get out and get in my car and go get a bite to eat someplace. You know, maybe it is time for a simple distraction fast. The students who are in my summer class know what I'm talking about here. Stop reading the negative posts on Facebook. Stop the conversations about how awful it is. You know, some people are still talking about how bad the economy is. That was happened 10 years ago, but they're still talking about it. And most of all, stop letting others' opinions cloud the truth, with a capital T. You know, what's true is we're experiencing some challenges right now. Elizabeth did not only alluded to it, but she flat out mentioned every one of them, right? So we all are experiencing challenges of some kind, whether they're financial, whether they're health, relationships, or maybe you just don't like the place you work and you need to find another job. If we are faced with challenging people in our lives, let them be our coaches. Step back and say, why am I challenged by this person? What is it in them that affects me? What is it in them that causes me discomfort? Is it possible that I may have these same characteristics they're exhibiting? Or is it I'm afraid I might have those same characteristics they're exhibiting? I can't notice something I don't have, right? And that's the hardest lesson I learned when I was first in this teaching. My teacher always used to say ABC, awareness builds consciousness. Once we have the awareness, we can't go back to before the awareness. I was married to someone for 23 years who was angry enough for both of us. I never had to be angry. I never had to express it. I was always the voice of reason, the mediator, the establishing the equilibrium of the entire family. I left the marriage, and I had to learn how to feel anger in an appropriate way. I honestly didn't really know how until I realized the difference between being angry and feeling angry. I learned that from Eckhart Tolle. Being angry is a lifetime experience. Feeling angry has a beginning and an end. If I feel angry, he said, Eckhart Tolle says, if I feel angry, investigate it. Find out what it's about. But if I am angry, that is part of my makeup. I don't want that to be part of my makeup. Anger doesn't change anything in the physical reality anyway. It's only a catalyst for change. Gloria Steinem said in the 60s, she said that change is not affected by complacence or contentment. It's only affected by irritation. If I find my own behavior irritating, I know I have to do something. I mean, I can find your behavior irritating and walk away from you. I can't get away from me. So if mine is irritating, then I have to do something. So begin to notice. I begin to notice when I felt frustrated, because when that happens, again, it's a call to prayer. Frustration is an indicator of a sense of separation from God. I've heard myself say in recent months, I'm sure others have said the same thing, I'm so frustrated right now. I had a flood in my house. Can you imagine not being with a kitchen or a laundry room for 4 weeks? That's frustrating. But I realized that this was an opportunity for me to do something. I had agreed with my class this summer that I would finish my book by the end of September without a kitchen and a laundry room. Oh, and by the way, the internet went out for a whole entire week. I was forced to sit down and finish my novel. I look at it in retrospect as some of the best days I've had in recent weeks. I could have had it one way, I could have had it another way, but I chose to make use of that time. Each time, my awareness is heightened because there's some incoherence in my relationship with Spirit. Each time I know there's incoherence, my relationship with Spirit has been heightened. Ernest Holmes says this. He said, all the words, thoughts, affirmations, and denials, the declarations and realizations in a spiritual mind treatment are for the purpose of bringing the consciousness of the practitioner, you're all practitioners, by the way, or the one speaking the treatment, to a higher level of spiritual acceptance. That's all this is about. It is truly a holy shift in consciousness. I am my own practitioner when I notice my disconnect from God. And when I do, I get to do treatment. It's the best thing. It's the great equalizer. It's the great centering prayer. Spiritual mind treatment looses the muddled consciousness of anyone and everyone willing to go to any lengths to free the spirit from congestion and confusion. Anybody here felt congested or confused lately? Yeah, you could probably all put your hands up. Ernest Holmes said, there's nothing ever to be healed. There is only a greater truth to be revealed. And when we have that greater truth, the healing takes care of itself. I told this story several years ago, but it bears repeating again because I need to hear it. A troubled woman was told that there was a local guru at the top of a mountain who lived in a solitary confinement, and he could solve every problem known to man. She donned her warmest coat and trekked the several miles up the mountain to visit with this man. Finally, she arrived and told him her plight, and he said she needed to meditate on the solution for her problem. She sat down and did as she was told. The next day, the guru came close to her with his walking stick. "Have you found the answer to your problem?" he asked. "No, master, I have not." At which point, he whacks her over the head with his cane. He walks away, telling her to meditate some more. He came back the next day and the next day, repeating the same procedure, whacking her over the head with his cane. On the fourth day, he came close to her, holding his stick at the ready. "Have you found the answer to your problem yet?" "No, master, I have not." He raised his arm to hit her, and she grabbed the stick from his hand. "No, master, I have not found the answer to my problem, but I've learned how to stop the pain." Now, some of these Middle Eastern stories can be elusive, but this one is not. It is not. The answer to a shift in consciousness may be elusive sometimes. And sometimes we just want to stop the pain. I felt like that in times in my life. There may be no immediate answer as to why things are the way they are right now. But when we are no longer affected and reactive to the outward stimuli, we will have arrived spiritually, and the way will be shown. I know it all sounds simple in theory to really free one's consciousness. It might not happen overnight, like Elizabeth said. A demonstration for some of the things we do our spiritual mind treatment for may not happen immediately because all the ducks aren't in a row for it to happen. And maybe our consciousness of receptivity is not there. But the more we practice peace and serenity in our lives, the less we are affected by the outward turmoil. I only tell you this today because I needed to hear it. When all else fails, the serenity prayer works for me. Can we say this together today? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Let's do it again. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference, knowing with God all things are possible. Namaste. Blue skies smiling at me, nothing but blue skies do I see. From now on, I never saw the sun shining so bright, never saw things going so right. Noticing the days hurrying by, when all is love, my how they fly. Blue days, all of them gone, nothing but blue skies.
from now on. I never saw the sun shining so bright, never saw things going so right, noticing the days hurrying by, when all is love, my how they fly. Blue days, all of them gone, nothing but blue skies from now on. Yeah!
Very wonderful music today. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. So, what's up now? Let me have a look here. All righty. We have the offering. All righty. I love this part. I love this part so much. Now, I put my check in the first service, but I'm a tithing member of this center. Even when I'm not here on Sunday, I tithe 10% of my income to this center every month. It is my privilege and pleasure to do this because it's the continuation of a ministry that has been here in this community for a long, long time. They've been in this particular building since 1976. So whatever you give today, give generously so that this ministry continues. If you'll hold your gift in your hand, you can repeat after me. Divine love consecrates my gift. It goes forth to heal, to prosper, and to bless. It is evidence of my conviction that God is the source and substance of my supply. I joyously contribute to the vision of this center, knowing that it returns to me multiplied abundantly.
Spirit gives through me, Spirit receives through me. Spirit lives and breathes through me. Yeah, yeah. Spirit lives and breathes through me.
Ooh. All right, so go within for just a moment and join me while I know the truth. That God is all there is, and God is the source and substance of my supply. That everything, expected and unexpected, comes to me by way of my own consciousness of receptivity. And so today I remove all the blocks. I let everything go. Anything that might impede my good in any way from showing up in my experience. I know today that this center is open and receptive to God's living spirit of truth by means of what has been given here today in these offering baskets. This ministry goes forth to bless this center, this community, this state, and the world because of the giving consciousness of each person here. And so it is that I joyfully receive and give thanks for this opportunity to give and to give generously. As we say together, and so it is. All right, children, come in. We have teens. Yes, we do. Hi, honey. How are you?
Good.
She used to work at Salada, and so it was always so much fun to go in there and have somebody serve me. My bowl was a small bowl, but it was much more generous when she worked there. Too bad you don't work there still. Oh, Presto Pasta. Is that where we're going or wherever Shirley is?
Yeah.
All right. Good. Tell us what you learned today here.
Okay. So today we reframed people who annoyed us and turned them into blessings. So we made a list of all the things that irritate us that they do and what we can learn from it.
Well, see, one mind. How's that? Oh, my gosh. I talked about that myself this morning. Excellent. So, good. Are there little children here today as well? They're still doing their stuff out there? All right. Well, we'll just know that they're in their right and perfect place doing that. I want to thank you all for being here today. I would like to bring Reverend Elizabeth up to do our closing treatment this morning. And bless you all. Wherever you're going, whatever you're doing today, remember to tell somebody that you love them.
I speak my word in the first person for each and every person here this morning. I declare there is one divine presence, one creative power of the universe. It is the source and substance of all that is. I am an individualization of that presence and expression of that power. It expresses as me, for me. I am one with the universal spirit. And I allow the light and the love of creator intelligence to flow through me, energizing and revitalizing my mind, my body, my spirit. I am energetic, yet calm, serene, and focused. And I surrender all negative and limiting thoughts. And I release myself from a structure of knowing that no longer serves me. I am free to begin a new experience of life. I see the God essence in myself as well as all the people around me. And I feel and heal. I heal any separation from God. I monitor and change any thoughts that steal my joy. I am proactive to become a center of harmony and beauty. I am relaxed, trusting that my life unfolds in right and perfect action. And I gratefully receive and give thanks for my serenity and more, and I release my work to the universe, to the law of mind, knowing it is already so. And together we say, so it is. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.